I assume you know what Stonehenge is. It's those big mysterious rocks in England. And when there's a mystery, we humans want to solve it. Researchers have been studying Stonehenge for hundreds of years now, and it turns out that we actually know a thing or two about it. Or in this case, we know 7 things about it. Stonehenge is a ring of giant standing stones, and it is so ancient that most of those stones have fallen or been lost to time. The Stonehenge you can go visit today has more than 90 visible stones or stone fragments. Look, I would love to tell you the exact number of stones, but we're going off a diagram for this estimate, and SciShow's budget does not include round-trip tickets to Stonehenge for me to go count them all in person. The arch-like structures are called trilithons, which is just a word for 2 upright stones with 1 horizontal stone called a lintel balanced across the top. They're made of huge carved blocks of sedimentary rock called sarsens or sarsen stones. The other half of the stones that make up Stonehenge are a different, smaller variety called bluestones. Bluestone is kind of misleading because they only sort of look blue-ish when they are wet, but we'll give whoever named them a pass this time. Stonehenge was built and used by different peoples in phases over a span of roughly 1,500 years, from about 3000 BCE to 1500 BCE. The sarsens and bluestones were brought from all over what's now known as the United Kingdom and arranged and rearranged over time. But I don't want to get ahead of myself. Now that we are on the same page, here are 7 very weird facts about the most famous circle of stones in the world. First is a little bit of a weird one, just some semantic pedantry for you. Stonehenge isn't a henge. A henge isn't just some fun English slang. It's a specific archaeological term that refers to a type of structure that was constructed between 3000 to 2000 BCE. It's basically a big ring of dirt with a gap in at least one section, kind of in the shape of a horseshoe or a power button icon. And there's at least one deep ditch along the inside. The 100 or so remaining henges in Britain and Ireland range from as small as a tennis court to several hundred meters across. They can be made up of concentric hills and valleys of dirt, but the order is important. While Stonehenge was originally a dirt ring constructed around the same time as true henges, many researchers think of it as more of like a proto-henge because the main ditch is outside the piled dirt, so maybe more of a practice run for the henge-building peoples. Now, the name isn't totally off base, or at least the first half isn't, since all the structural components of Stonehenge are stones, and that's more meaningful than it sounds. Actually, most people use the word stone and rock interchangeably, but archaeologists typically use rock to mean the original chunk of earth and stone to mean a rock that humans have moved, modified, or used in some way. This makes sense to me, but I never thought about it until just now. And all of the sarsens and bluestones that make up Stonehenge definitely fit that definition of stone. Alright, now here is where this fun fact takes a twist. Even though it's not a real henge, all henges are actually named after Stonehenge. Like, the reason we have the word henge is that it comes from what everyone was calling Stonehenge back before archaeologists got involved. In linguistics, this is called a back formation, where you take part of a bigger word and then make that new bit its own word. The name Stonehenge probably came from the Germanic phrase Stonhengen, which means stone hanging or stone gallows. So we think henge could describe those horizontal lintel stones hanging in the air, or implies that trilithons kind of looked like gallows. Some of the oldest evidence that we have of the word henge being written down was a shortened form of Stonehenge in a 1792 poem. And it's kind of just like how every scandal is a gate these days, from like Gamergate to Deflategate, we started naming circular monuments made of upright things after Stonehenge, including the nearby Woodhenge. Woodhenge was actually constructed around the same time out of rings of timber and dirt, but it's been overshadowed by its stonier cousin. In any case, archaeologists started using the word henge as a standalone term in the 1930s to refer to the thing that is identical between both Stonehenge and Woodhenge, which is the dirt rings, which is how the namesake of a henge got kicked out of its own club of hinges. But Hengegate isn't the only time that archaeologists have gotten interested in Stonehenge. We have records of people studying Stonehenge going back hundreds of years, and they basically haven't stopped since. The The earliest written accounts were made when wealthy men, sometimes called gentlemen scholars or antiquaries, went around exploring historical sites and documenting whatever they found interesting. For instance, the antiquary John Aubrey did a pretty accurate site drawing of Stonehenge in 1666, while William Stukeley published a book in 1740 made up of his observations of, quote, those remarkable circles of stones which we find all over the kingdom. Stukeley spent a lot of time at Stonehenge and first used the term trilithon to describe its iconic arches, and he's also credited with first documenting how the summer solstice sunrise aligns with the monument, aside from, you know, the people who made it that way. They also were aware of that. And the list of past and present archaeologists studying Stonehenge is long, and they've investigated all kinds of questions about the land, the stones, and the people who cared about this monument. But not all scientists who visit Stonehenge want to know about the site itself. Some come for the earthworms. Charles Darwin's last published scientific book was about earthworms and how they interact with soil. Yeah, that is that Charles Darwin. And some of his studies in the mid-1800s involved the Stonehenge sarsens. He knew the stones were above ground at some point and had fallen and then were buried in soil over time, possibly due to the worm activity. As they ate organic matter and pooped out castings, they basically built new soil layers on top of the old stones. So not only is Stonehenge's legacy a long and impressive one, so is the legacy of archaeology on Stonehenge. A little meta, isn't it? But solving Stonehenge's mysteries requires funding, and so do we. So here is a quick ad break.
Thanks to ACT for supporting this SciShow video. ACT is the number one taken college admissions test in nearly half of US states based on 2024 grad class data. It's accepted by all colleges. And now, ACT is giving students more choice on how you test to get your best score possible. You can take it online or on paper and with or without science questions. Plus, you can try out real ACT science questions beforehand at quizme.act.org. The enhanced ACT also gives you the shortest test time yet, with 44 fewer questions, which means more time per question and less stress. You can learn more about the ACT or register for the next upcoming test at act.org/scishow, the QR code, or the link in the description.
While Stonehenge has been a topic of research for hundreds of years, it's also been the focus of changing ideas about conservation of important archaeological sites. And that starts with who even owns it, because for the vast majority of its time in the modern record, it was on private property. A man named Cecil Chubb bought the land where Stonehenge sits in 1915, and 3 years later gave the land as a gift to the nation of England, which was nice of him, since it meant that researchers would have a lot more access and the government could help protect the monument. But if you look at older photos or illustrations of Stonehenge from around that time, you might notice that they only sort of look like the pictures you'd see today. Like this 1835 watercolor by the artist John Constable looks a lot more crumbly than picturesque. And that's because alongside carefully excavating Stonehenge, there have been lots of restoration attempts, with mixed results. Throughout the 1900s, people used heavy engineering equipment to restack trilithons, replace fallen lintels, and straighten out crooked bluestones. And they've had to do it like a few times. So after they got tired of needing to restack the world's heaviest Jenga blocks, they came up with a more permanent solution. The bases of many wobbly sarsens were set into poured concrete foundations to hold them upright. I feel like this isn't gonna be great. These restorations were proposed and supervised by some archaeologists who had conducted excavations at Stonehenge, but this restoration has been criticized in hindsight. Some current archaeologists have emphasized that now that we've made these changes, we owe it to visitors and researchers alike to publicly acknowledge the ways that Stonehenge has been changed, and it isn't a time capsule of the past. And because concrete is concrete, these are changes we can never undo. There are no take-backsies in excavation or in concrete pouring. As we continue to excavate and study the stones of Stonehenge, we're learning more about their composition, too. And it turns out that the bluestones make distinctive sounds when they are thumped. There's even some evidence that the people who put them there knew that. See, we have known for a long time that these bluestones were special. While the sarsens of Stonehenge were hauled from around 25 kilometers away, the bluestones may have been brought here from more than 200 200 kilometers away. So obviously a big question for archaeologists has been why? Like, why were these blue stones so important that people put in the effort to move them so far? One hypothesis is that there was a pre-Stonehenge circle of blue stones constructed in Wales. Then, around 3000 BCE, they were all moved right around the same time Stonehenge would have initially been constructed. So maybe a migrating group of people wanted to bring their monument with them. Other blue stones may have been brought over in a more piecemeal fashion, though, and another group of researchers hypothesized that these blue stones were specifically sourced because they're a kind of lithophone, a rock that makes like a pretty resonant sound after it's hit. We're still not actually sure why certain rocks ring while others don't, beyond the fact that it has to do with their internal structure, which allows sound waves to propagate. Most rocks just make a dull thud when you hit them because they dampen those vibrations instead of conducting them or amplifying them. The stones themselves have little impact dents on them too, which leads some to suggest that they might have been chosen for their musical properties. And of course, it's hard to tell exactly what these blue stones would have sounded like, or what else they were used for before earthworms half buried them, or they were reconstructed with concrete. But all of this suggests that Stonehenge may be the birthplace of rock music. It sounds like a major undertaking to move many of these huge rocks 200 kilometers, but as unpleasant as that must have been, hauling Stonehenge's altar stone was even worse. The altar stone is the name of one of the central giant stones with a mass of around 6 metric tons. It's mostly buried underground, and no, we don't actually know if it was ever used as an altar. We think it may have gotten its modern name from an offhanded speculation from an English architect. And according to a paper published in August 2024, the altar stone may have been brought to the site from more than 750 kilometers away, from a site in what is now Scotland. To figure this out, researchers extracted a couple of different minerals from the stone called zircon, apatite, and rutile. All three of these minerals sometimes contain trace amounts of uranium atoms, which radioactively decay over time into lead atoms, and that can help us estimate the age of the rock they're embedded in, up to millions or billions of years. Some of the mineral grains they tested were around 450 million years old, while others were around a billion years old. And this combination matched the composition of rock in the Orcadian Basin in northern Scotland, which is about as far as you can get on the UK landmass from Stonehenge in southern England. And you thought moving a couch into your new place was hard. It was. You did great. So we know a lot about how the rocks got to this place, but we know less about the people who moved them. Many groups of humans who lived in the area during the early phases of construction were semi-nomadic, meaning it can be hard to find evidence connecting them to Stonehenge directly. Plus, when it came time to bury the dead, some of these cultures opted for cremation as opposed to burial, so there aren't always remains for researchers to study. Fortunately, DNA evidence can help. Molecular biologists are taking some educated guesses with the human bones we do have, especially the ones that were buried near Stonehenge. The biologists isolate as much usable DNA as they can, make lots of copies of the fragments, and then read the sequence of DNA base pairs. They use computers to catalog all of this data in a DNA library and stitch overlapping fragments together as best as possible, like puzzle pieces in a giant, terrible puzzle that only a computer could do. Then they can look for genetic markers like single nucleotide polymorphisms, or SNPs, which are DNA base pairs that vary between different individual humans or populations. And by comparing these new DNA libraries to existing DNA libraries, they can get a sense of what groups are most similar to the remains that were found at Stonehenge. The DNA evidence from nearby burials suggests that early phases of construction at Stonehenge may have been the work of two groups of people, the Western European hunter-gatherers and the early European farmers. And there's also evidence that when another group, called the Belbeker culture, moved into the region, they started to use Stonehenge as a cultural hub too, even though they had nothing to do with its original construction. The DNA also suggests that when the Belbekers came to town, they didn't merge with the other indigenous groups right away. Instead, both groups stayed friendly, non-interbreeding neighbors for hundreds of years before their populations eventually merged. Obviously, there's still a lot missing from this story, but it's cool to think about how Stonehenge brought these people together. There's still plenty we do not know about the humans who built and interacted with Stonehenge. So if you're looking for mysteries, Stonehenge certainly has them. But it's just as important to reflect on all the progress we have made in demystifying this incredible, weird monument, all without any written records. Go science!